understanding, good and quite simply a sober assessment of the situation. We don't want to get rid of each other, and we'll never be able to get rid of each other. Why should we try to get rid of such beautiful people? Even those who don't like Soviet people, those Americans who don't like Soviets, and I'm sure there are Americans like that, even they must understand that they will never be able to get rid of the Soviet people, especially keeping in mind the fact that even among ourselves there are some very good people too. This too must be understood. We must realize that we need each other, that only together can we overcome the problems that we are faced with today. Somebody compared our contemporary life to a train thundering on. The locomotive is the arms race, and the carriages, the cars, are global problems like hunger, poverty, environmental pollution, demographic problems, epidemics, old ones and new ones. This engine, this locomotive of the arms race, is pulling all those global problems towards an abyss, and we must stop it, at least as the first step, and then set to business solving those global problems that neither the Americans on their own, nor the Soviets on their own, nor any other nation on its own can solve. Let us solve them together. Let us then consider this seminar of ours, which is going to work until the 12th of this month. Let us dedicate it to looking ahead. Let us look into the future, not settle accounts, not accuse each other, you were wrong there and you were wrong there. This is a useless, futile stand. Let us be specific, looking into the future, discussing what we can do for the future. For those who do not yet know the timetable, I'm going to outline it, but first I'm going to introduce a highly respected person, a few highly respected people who are very important in the arts and the media of their country, the United States. I'm not going to introduce the Soviets present, because those Soviets who are here or who are going to watch the proceedings on television know most of the faces present here. And the Americans will get to know these people, and I'm sure there will be a natural friendship that will spring up. But about the Americans, I'd like to introduce some of the prominent people present here. A writer, author of the monograph, The Face of the Enemy on the Other Side, Samuel King and John Galperin. The producer of Rocky IV, Robert Chatov. We're not applauding the movie, mind you. We're applauding the fact that he is here. The music director of Honolulu Symphony and Opera, George Baratti, and a number of other outstanding American guests. We're going to be able to really get to know each other in the course of these few days. We're not going to have plenary sessions only. There will be six roundtable groups, workshops, whatever you care to call them, where very specific things will be discussed, having to do with the theater, the cinema, the media, and so on and so forth. In order to prove to ourselves that we can have real joint projects, that that is feasible and entirely possible. We want, at the time of the seminar itself, to agree on setting up a group to produce a Soviet-American feature film, Cowboys and Cossacks, also set up an exchange of cartoons between the New Times magazine and American weeklies, to set up a Soviet-American animated film, and to set up a project to make a Soviet-American documentary focusing on a Soviet family living somewhere in the provinces in Siberia and an American family living in the heartland someplace, say in Texas, if that's a good enough comparison with Siberia. That documentary might tell people how the life of ordinary families is alike everywhere, in spite of all the differences. Their concerns, their cares, their joys, and the jokes they laugh at, and the things they cry about are very similar. That might be a very interesting film indeed. We have been thinking about ways to intertwine the lives of these two families, and we think that we're not going merely to observe the two families and show them in turn, as it were. We want this really to become intermingled. If an American daddy is scolding his son for having come back from school with a bad mark, then it's the Soviet son who will reply to the American daddy. Or say it's raining outside and the American mommy is going out, but the Russian mommy is getting soaking wet. Because we're all living under the same skies, on the same earth, and we share so much. And we want to demonstrate that people do share a lot, that even though there is a lot of difference in their lives, basically, we worry, we laugh, and we grieve in the same ways. And of course, it's madness to have something phantasmagoric beside those families living in Texas and in Siberia, something that can destroy all of us on this planet. This has been a fairly rambling introduction, and I apologize for that. I only meant to open this extremely interesting, I think, fascinating meeting. And I have changed my mind, and I'm going to introduce a few of the Soviet participants also. On my left is our well-known film director, vice chairman of the Soviet Peace Committee, Stanislav Rostovsky. Further on the left, a well-known Soviet poet, Andrei Dementyev, editor-in-chief of the UNOST magazine. A very well-known and well-loved actress, people's artist of the USSR, Elina Bystritskaya. An almost legendary personality on my right. A very, very fine actor, loved by the audiences, I think not only here, but in many countries, Inokentiy Smoktunovsky. Over there, Vasily Lanovoy, sitting very modestly. At first, his name is known to every Soviet person. Right here in the middle, in the aisle, outside of the battle, as it were, is Vladimir Poznan, who is doing a lot for the understanding of our two nations. In the first row over there is Juna, who is very well known in this country, and we do not even know what she can do to promote friendship between our two nations. I think she can do a lot. A very gifted person. Apart from doing things that are scientifically unexplainable, she writes verse and she paints. A few of her pictures are over there on the back wall, and an exhibition of her paintings will be open in this building day after tomorrow. The Soviet composer Zak, I don't know him, his face, but he's a very well-known composer. Also present here. Quite a few wonderful people, please believe me. And then Rama, Vernon, perhaps we'll introduce some of the other Americans. Our seminar is going to be concluded by a gala concert. Situation in the world, but I'm sure it will be helpful in bringing that about. I wish you a good success and a good beginning. Thank you. Now, I'd like to introduce a person whom I love, a woman whom I love, Rama Vernon, who is the heart and soul of this entire operation.
Прежде всего, позвольте...
Our dear, dear friends, from the depths of our hearts, and I feel that I represent the entire American delegation in saying this, we thank so much for their great efforts and time and creativity that they've given to bringing forth this conference this week, and that is the Soviet Peace Committee. And we thank all the other organizations whom they have coordinated to bring about this conference, which we feel is an unprecedented event in both Soviet and American history. This morning, I received calls from the Soviet media as preparing to leave to come here. And the question was, from all of them, what do you hope to achieve out of this week? And as each one of our delegation has come with different hopes and different dreams and different visions of achievement, I think one thing that we can all, both Soviets and Americans, share is that we hope to achieve a new beginning. That the end of this week will not be the end of the conference on Soviet-American images, but it will be only the beginning. This is a time of exciting change within the Soviet Union and in the relationship between our two countries. And I feel that the Americans who have come to taken great efforts to be here for this week are riding the crest of the wave of these changes. And it is a time that we can all now, Soviets and Americans, cultivate open and productive relationships which can contribute to unprecedented breakthroughs in international understanding through artistic collaboration. We have come to explore the images, and as Henry so beautifully put it, not to dwell on the past, but to look to the future. But in looking to the future, we must also understand the past and forgive one another for the past, so that we can look to a very positive future. Just as our arts and media in the past have contributed to division and separation of our two countries, we now know that it can also contribute to bridges of understanding. We are all here in the spirit of bridging the gaps of understanding. And we have come with open minds and, more important, open hearts. And as Henry used the word love, this is the greatest thing that will bridge the gaps between our two nations. And Mother Teresa was recently here in the Peace Committee, where she gave a beautiful blessing to the Peace Committee. And when she was asked about the Afghanistan situation, she simply said, I have come. That is not my purpose for coming. I have come here to love the people. And I feel I can speak for many, many in our group who feel the same way. And as I look at all of you, Soviets and Americans, and see the familiar faces of my dear, dear Soviet friends, I know that you too have the same feelings. This symposium, we all hope, will be more than just a meeting of the minds, but that it will be a heart-to-heart exchange. And in future collaborations, it will be an important catalyst in discovering new ways in which film, media, performing arts, and our literature, the most powerful communications vehicles of all, can be used to contribute toward deeper understanding between the people of our two nations. And again, we thank you all for the great efforts that you have given to bring us all here today. Thank you.
For those who do not yet know Rama Vernon, she is the director of the Center for Soviet-American Dialogue. I now recognize a member of the Executive Council of the Center for Soviet-American Dialogue, futurologist, writer, and public figure, Barbara Max Hubbard.
Thank you so much. I want to reiterate what Rama said in terms of our thanks to the Soviet Peace Committee. As a veteran of conferences, a veteran of efforts to bring people together, I would like to say to both the Americans and the Soviet participants that working with the Soviet Peace Committee has been one of the most creative experiences of our lives. We have found such receptivity and such imagination here that we are truly privileged to be part of this co-sponsoring of this event. I would like to take a moment to set the context for our conference, because it has always been clear to me that the most important idea anyone has is the idea they have of themselves and of others, because that image affects our behavior. For as we see ourselves, so we act. And as we act, so we become. In great periods of history, there have emerged new images of humanity that have inspired us, as in 5th century Greece, for example, when the idea of the individual emerged. That's a very interesting observation about our time, that since the Renaissance, we have had a gradual disintegration of our self-image. And it is very difficult to see today the image of humanity. What do we look like? Who are we? We are seeking new images, not simply of Soviet Americans, but new images of the global humanity. Of what do we look like with all our power, our science, our technology, our industry, our communications, our consciousness? What would be an image of ourselves commensurate with our powers now? We have seen the destructive images, and I believe that exhibition downstairs by Gennady Dobrov is one of the most moving experiences that I have ever seen of the images of the pain of what has been created. So now we have the opportunity here at the beginning of the new epoch in our relationship to create new Soviet-American images of each other. And if we place this in the historic or even cosmic context, as the two superpowers on Earth, with the powers to destroy or literally to co-create new worlds, the images that we two peoples come forth with could be effective in changing our behavior on this planet. Because art is a key to history. It always has been, and it certainly is now. So we have a tremendous opportunity here to develop new images of ourselves in the context of a planet that now has the potential of self-destruction or transformation. This conference is part two of a three-part series, which collectively is really a very powerful set of events. The first part one, of which we are part two, occurred in March of 1987. It was called A New Way of Thinking in the Nuclear Age, Social Inventions for the Third Millennium. And we brought 32 Americans, and the Soviet Peace Committee selected some 58 Soviets. And we met together in small groups looking for joint projects in global politics, entrepreneurship, communications, health, psychology. And we discovered that the key to the next step is working together. The first step is understanding each other. The second step is creating together out of personal interest and in the project. The word social invention has become quite important to us because it means personal initiative to work together on projects that each individual deeply cares about, that we create ourselves. That conference was an unprecedented breakthrough in relationship as far as all of us were concerned. This conference is part two. And Henry, when we arrived and heard each other's projects, the Americans are coming bearing gifts. Each person in this room has a personal gift, a project that they hope they can accomplish. And I'm sure that the same is true of each Soviet. And sometime, those of us who work on these conferences feel like matchmakers. Yeah. And these are wonderful matches that we become co-creators together, and that's what we are hoping to do.